Kathleen has a PhD in English from NYU and started out looking at representations of technology in literature. And as she was telling me over lunch, she became increasingly interested in the technologies rather than their representations, and has wandered into what I think is probably the most crucial area facing the academy, which is the question of publication, and certainly something that KU has been really concerned about, and I think on the forefront of, with commitments to open access and things like that. So we were excited that Kathleen agreed to come hear us speak, and I'll just turn it over to her. She's going to be talking about publishing and technology and the future of the academy, and we'll have question and answer afterwards, so store up all your excellent questions. So thank you, Kathleen.
Thank you. A couple of things that I want to start out by saying, the usual sort of caveat as I begin. The project that I'm talking about, given my history in English, mostly relates to book publishing and the future of book publishing within the academy. But I think a lot of it is sort of broadly applicable to thinking about the situation with journal publishing right now as well. So I think there's a certain amount of translation that would need to go on there, but I am mostly focusing on those humanities fields that are still requiring books as the primary form of publication. The talk itself is an overview of a much larger project, which is to say that the talk is sort of mostly an introduction. It's somewhat long on generalization and a little bit shorter on detail. So I hope that our discussion afterward might bring out some of that detail that gets glossed over here. Those are my caveats. I'm going to begin now with two epigraphs. The first of which is from Cass Sunstein's Infotopia. In many cases, traditions last not because they are excellent, but because influential people are averse to change and because of the sheer burdens of transition to a better state. And secondly, from Lindsay Waters' Enemies of Promise, there is no way to stop the shakeup of the university press system from happening. It has already begun. So the project that I'm here to talk to you about today is very much future-oriented. It's focused on the changes in scholarly publishing and scholarly communication that are beginning to take root around us. But I start in the past, in no small part because certain aspects of the ways that we work as scholars, particularly within the humanities, are rapidly becoming obsolete. And I think we need to understand this obsolescence carefully, clearly, if the changes around us are going to be productive. Now, the term obsolescence, which is one that's popped up in my work a lot, functions as a kind of catch-all for a number of very different conditions, each of which demands different sorts of analysis and response. Too often, we fall into a conventional association of obsolescence with the death of this or that cultural form, which is a linkage that I argue really needs to be broken if the academy is going to take full stock of its role in contemporary culture and to fairly assess its means of producing and disseminating knowledge. Now, for instance, the obsolescence that I focused on in my first book, which was entitled The Anxiety of Obsolescence, The American Novel in the Age of Television, the obsolescence in this title was not, or at least not primarily, material in nature. My argument was that neither the novel in particular, nor the book more broadly, nor print in general is in any sense dead. However, in The Anxiety of Obsolescence, I argued that claims about the obsolescence of certain kinds of cultural forms often say more about those doing the claiming than they do about the object of the claim. In fact, agonized claims of the death of technologies like print and genres like the novel sometimes function to recreate an elite cadre of cultural producers and consumers who are ostensibly operating on the margins of contemporary culture and profiting from those claims of marginality by creating a sense that their values, which were once ostensibly part of a utopian mainstream and are now apparently waning, must be protected. Right? So the obsolescence that these kinds of claims point to are thus obviously less a material state than a political project, one that's aimed at intervening in contemporary culture in order to shore up certain kinds of waning hierarchies. Now, I'm starting this talk, which is ostensibly about my new project, by discussing my last project in no small part because of what happened once I had finished the manuscript. Naively, I had assumed that publishing a book that makes the argument that the book is not a dying form wouldn't be that hard. that publishers might actually have some stake in getting an argument like that out into circulation. What I hadn't counted on, though, as I worked on the revisions prior to submitting the manuscript for review, was the effect that the dot-com crash of the early 2000s, the effect that it would end up having on university presses. So in December 2003, I received an email message from the editor of the scholarly press that had had the manuscript under review for the previous 10 months. The news was not good. The press was declining to publish the book. And the note, which was as encouraging a rejection as rejection can ever be, stressed that insofar as fault could be attributed, it lay not with the manuscript, but with the climate. The press had received two enthusiastically positive readers reports, and the editor was likewise supportive of the project, but the marketing department had overruled him on the editorial board, declaring that the book posed too much financial risk to pursue in the current economy. Oh, and sadly, that is a quote. This particular cause for rejection prompted two immediate responses, one of which was most clearly articulated by my mother, who said, "They were planning on making money off of your book?" Well, the fact is they were, right? Not much, perhaps, but that the press involved needed the book to make money, at least enough to recover its costs, and that it doubted that it would, highlights one of the most significant problems facing academic publishing today, an utterly insupportable economic model. Sadly, it was a Google image in which I had done a search for the crisis in scholarly publishing in October 2009 and come up with 176,000 hits. Indicating that there is plenty of discussion out there to indicate that the evidence for this problem and for the financial issues that rest at its heart extend far beyond my own personal anecdotal case. Now, though these kinds of problems have been building for a long time, this crisis has been around, and we've been being warned about it for quite some time, things nonetheless suddenly got much, much worse right after the dot-com bubble burst. During this dramatic turn in the stock market, when many university budgets took a nosedive, a situation that begins to seem now like mere foreshadowing, among the academic units whose budgets took the hardest hits were university presses and university libraries. And the cuts in funding for libraries, of course, represented a further budget cut for presses, as numerous libraries, which were already straining under the exponentially rising costs of journals, especially in the sciences, managed the cutbacks to their budgets by reducing the number of monographs that they purchased. And the result for many university library users was perhaps only a slightly longer wait to get a hold of any title that they needed, as libraries increasingly turned to consortial arrangements for collection sharing. But the result for presses was devastating. Imagine, for a university press of the caliber of, say, Harvard, the expectation for decades had been that they could count on every library in the University of California system purchasing a copy of each title that they published. Since 2001, however, the rule has increasingly been that one library in the system will buy that title, and one can only imagine what the situation is today given the California state budget. So the same has happened with every such library system around the country, such that, as Jennifer Crew noted in 2004, sales of monographs to libraries at that point were less than one-third of what they had been only a few years before. And again, that was in 2004, well before this current crisis. So library cutbacks have resulted in vastly reduced sales for university presses at precisely the same moment when severe cutbacks in the percentage of university press budgets that were provided through institutional subsidies have made those presses dependent on sales, on income from sales for their survival. The average university press receives well under 10% of its annual budget from its institution. And again, one can only imagine what's happening to that figure in the current climate. So it's for this reason that I argue that the financial model under which university press publishing operates is simply not sustainable into the future. And if we're waiting for a bailout, it's not coming. A foretaste of what is coming, however, has been visible for a while now, as numerous presses are being shut down by their institutions, and as those that survive are required to reduce the number of titles that they publish each year, and as marketing concerns come absolutely of necessity to outweigh scholarly merit in making publication decisions. Now, in my own individual case, things turned out well. The book got picked up, if only well over a year later, by a smaller press, one that had a larger subsidy and thus more modest sales expectations. And the book managed to exceed those expectations, and as well, ironically, as the needs of that earlier press, but that's another story. But despite the fact that The Anxiety of Obsolescence was finally successfully published, and this experience head-on of the crisis in academic publishing led me to start rethinking my argument about the continued viability of the book as a form. I mean, perhaps there is a particular kind of book, the academic book, that is indeed threatened with a real obsolescence. I mean, even so, this is not to say that the academic book is dead. Right? These books are still published, after all, if not exactly in the numbers that we might need them to be to satisfy all our hiring and tenure requirements. And they are still sold, right? If not exactly in the numbers that they needed to be in order to support the presses that put them out. But the academic book is in a pretty curious state, one that might usefully trouble our associations of obsolescence with the death of cultural technologies. For while the academic book is no longer viable as a primary means of scholarly communication, it's nonetheless still required. Right? If anything, the academic book isn't dead, it's undead. Exercising a kind of power over the ways that we work without really truly being alive. Now, if this is the case, if the academic book is undead, how are we supposed to respond? There's, of course, a real question to ask about how far I want to carry this metaphor. The suggestion that contemporary academic publishing is governed by a kind of zombie logic, for instance, might be read as indicating that these old forms refuse to stay put in their graves, but instead walk the earth rotting and putrescent, wholly devoid of consciousness, eating the brains of the living, and susceptible to nothing but decapitation. And this might seem a bit of an over-response. On the other hand, it's worth considering the extensive scholarship in media studies on the figure of the zombie. Which is often understood to act as a stand-in for the narcotized subject of capitalism, particularly at those moments when capitalism's contradictions become most apparent. I mean, if there is a relationship between the zombie and the subject of late capitalism, this one was Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice and Zombies. The cultural anxiety that that figure marks is currently, and with reason, off the charts. So far off the charts, in fact. This was my favorite of all of the zombie images. It's a lolcat. So far off the charts, in fact, that many are suggesting that the zombie has jumped the shark. A sentence that probably has never been used in an academic lecture before, but at any rate, zombies are everywhere. I have no idea what this image was. I'm sorry, I can't tell you. This one was seen from a school hallway. Zombies are everywhere, and not least within the academy, as we find our ways of communicating increasingly threatened with a sort of death in life, this slide intentionally left blank. But also find our livelihoods themselves decreasingly lively, as the liberal arts are overtaken by the teaching of supposedly more pragmatic fields, as tenure-track faculty lines are rapidly being replaced with more contingent forms of labor, and as too many newly minted PhDs find themselves without the job opportunities that they need to survive. Okay, just to be clear. I'm not really suggesting that the future survival of the academy requires us to put academic publishing safely in its grave, but I'm not being wholly facetious either, as I do want to indicate that certain aspects of the academic publishing process are neither quite as alive as we'd like them to be, nor quite as dead as might be most convenient. I mean, it's likely that we could get along fine for the most part with the undead of academic publishing, as studies of radio and the vinyl LP, for instance, indicate that obsolete media forms have always had curious afterlives. But one key difference between those cases and the case of the academic book is, of course, that we don't yet have a good replacement. It's thus important for us to consider the work that the book is and isn't doing for us, the ways that it remains a vibrant and vital form of scholarly communication, and the ways that it's become undead, haunting the living from beyond the grave. But a few distinctions are necessary first. The obsolescence faced by the academic book is not primarily material any more than was the obsolescence of the novel that I studied before. A radical shift to all digital delivery would by itself do nothing to revive the form. I mean, however much I would personally insist that we in the humanities must move beyond our singular focus on ink on paper to understand and take advantage of pixels on screens, the physical form of print actually still functions perfectly well in most cases. And in fact, numerous studies have indicated that a simple move to electronic distribution within the current system of academic publishing will not be enough to bail the system out, as printing, storing, and distributing the material form of the book only represents a fraction of its current production costs. And in fact, as many have pointed out, the digital may in fact be more prone to a material obsolescence than is print. But even that obsolescence has different valences. I mean, on the one hand, there's the obsolescence that you encounter if you try to read a first generation hypertext like cover page of Michael Joyce's Afternoon on a contemporary Mac, and I won't go into, this is actually kind of appropriate for that. I won't go into the particulars, but it's almost impossible to get Michael Joyce's Afternoon to run on a current Mac. And on the other hand, the sort of obsolescence that's engineered into the form of the blog, which is not supposed to be obsolete, a form that seems utterly designed for ephemera, right? Each post scrolls down the front page and off into the archives, and yet the apparent ephemerality of the blog bears within it a surprising durability, right? Thanks to the technologies of searching, filtering, and archiving that have developed across the web, as well as to the networked conversation that keep those archives in play. Blogs do die, right? Sometimes when their authors stop posting, sometimes when they're deleted, but even when apparently dead, a blog persists in archives and caches and continues to draw readers in through old links and search engines. So a form of obsolescence may be engineered into a blog's architecture, but this ephemerality is misleading. Our interactions with blogs keep them alive long after they've apparently died. Now, I want to hold up, alongside the kinds of interactions that are produced by blogs, the state of the academic book, which I would argue faces an obsolescence that is not primarily material, but instead institutional in nature, arising from the environment in which it's produced. I mean, if, after all, there's something obsolete about the book, it's not its content, right? Despite my general conviction that the book shouldn't be the make-or-break form of scholarship and tenure reviews in the humanities, there's still a kind of large-scale synthetic work that gets done in books that really remains important to the development of scholarly thought. So it's not that the book's content is obsolete, but again, it's also not the form, right? The pages still turn perfectly fine as opposed to Michael Joyce's Afternoon. What has ceased to function in the academic book is the system itself, right? The process through which that book comes into being. Now, I mentioned earlier that the message that I had received from that press, declining my book on financial grounds, produced two immediate responses, the first of which was my mother's bewildered disbelief, and the second came from my colleague Matt Kirschenbaum, who left a comment on my blog saying that he couldn't understand why I couldn't simply take the entire manuscript and the two positive readers' reports and post the whole thing online, right? Voila, peer-reviewed publication. Where, in fact, it would likely garner a readership both wider and larger than the same manuscript in print would. Now, he went on to say that, in fact, he understood why that wasn't realistic, particularly not at that moment in time, and that he wasn't seriously advocating it. Nor am I suggesting that we all become our own online publishers, at least not unless that's part of a continuum of different options. But the point is, the system's broken, and it's time we got busy fixing it. What ought to count is peer review and scholarly merit, not the physical form in which the text is ultimately delivered. Now, this exchange with Matt and a number of other conversations that I had in the ensuing months convinced me to stop thinking about scholarly publishing as a system that would always be there, that would just sort of magically bring my work into being, and instead approach it as the object of that work. I'm thinking seriously about both the institutional models and the material forms through which scholarship might best circulate. About the time I began a fairly vague set of discussions about the possibility of founding an all-electronic scholarly press, this is the cover page of the Modern Language Association's task force report from the Task Force on the Evaluation of Scholarship for Tenure and Promotion, which gets released right at about this same point. The recommendations of this task force included a couple of strong calls to departments. First of all, to give serious consideration to articles published by tenure candidates, thus decentering the book as the gold standard of scholarly production, and to communicate that expanded range of acceptable venues for publication to their administrations. The task force also urged those departments to acknowledge that scholarship of many different varieties is taking place online and to evaluate that scholarship without media-related bias. Now, obviously, these were extremely important recommendations, but there was a significant degree of easier said than done in the response that the report received, and for no small reason. In effect, they call for a substantive rethinking, not simply of the processes through which the Academy tenures its faculty, but in how those faculty do their work, how they communicate that work, how that work is read both inside and outside the Academy. I mean, these changes can't simply be technological, right? They have to be institutional and social as well. And so the two projects that I've been working on since are both aimed at creating the kinds of change that I think is necessary for the survival of scholarly publishing in the humanities into the 21st century. The first of these is MediaCommons, a digital scholarly publishing network focused on media studies, which my co-editor Abby Santo and I have been working on with the support of the Institute for the Future of the Book, with an NEH Digital Startup Grant, and the support of the NYU Digital Library Technology Services Group. MediaCommons, which you see here, is working to become a space in which the multiplicity of conversations that are taking place in media studies around various spaces on the web can be brought together through projects like In Syndication, which is in the bottom left-hand corner, which aggregates a number of different blogs in the field. But we're also publishing a range of original projects, the longest running of which is In Media Race, which asks 5 scholars a week to comment briefly on some up-to-the-minute media text as a means of opening discussion about the issues that it presents for media scholars, students, practitioners, and activists. The newest of our projects is The New Everyday. The New Everyday is an experiment in what's been called middle state publishing, focusing on articles that are slightly more formal than blog posts, but not yet as developed as the journal article, which is part of our attempts to understand the role of ongoing discussion within a significantly broadened scholarly ecosystem, in which the outputs of scholarship come in a much wider range of weights and time signatures than what we're used to, from the blog post all the way up to the monograph. And we are publishing those longer forms as well through MediaCommons Press, which is another of our projects. And in this one, we're publishing longer texts for open discussion, some of which are moving through the digital phase on the way to a primary life in print, such as the experiment in open review that we conducted on the part of Shakespeare Quarterly for their special issue on Shakespeare and new media, which was released in the fall, an experiment that the Shakespeare Quarterly board considered so successful that we're about to repeat it with this year's coming special issue. Other projects are meant to have a primary digital existence, including a series of television studies case files that we're hoping to launch later this year. But the primary importance is MediaCommons, as far as I'm concerned, is the network that it attempts to build among scholars in the field. Getting those scholars in communication with one another, right? Discussing and possibly collaborating on their projects. And to that end, we've built what would be a peer network backbone for the system, what I've been referring to as Facebook for scholars for a while now. And I don't know if any of you read the Chronicle of Higher Education, but there was an article in the Chron this morning on Facebook for scientists. And I just want to say we've been doing this for 3 years. Anyway, Facebook for scholars. Sadly, I wish I could show that to you. Through this profile system, scholars can gather together the writing that they're doing across the web, as well as citations for offline work, creating a digital portfolio that provides a snapshot of their scholarly identities. Now, working on this project has taught me several things, all of which I sort of knew already, but hadn't ever really fully internalized. One of which is that any software development project will inevitably take far longer than you could possibly predict at the outset. And the second and more important is that no matter how slowly such software development projects move, the rate of change within the Academy is positively glacial by comparison. And so it's my need to advocate for this kind of change that has led to the other project, the one that I'm mostly talking from today. For while there have been numerous publications in the last few years that have argued for the needs for new systems and practices in scholarly publishing, including, just to name two, John Walensky's The Access Principle and Christine Borgman's Scholarship in the Digital Age, the arguments that these texts make are too often fail to account for the fundamentally conservative nature of academic institutions and the academics that comprise them. In the main, we are extraordinarily resistant to change in our ways of working. So it's not for no reason that a senior colleague of mine once joked to me that the motto of my own institution, and one that I think might be usefully extended to many institutions, could well be, "We have never done it that way before." Well, as Donald Hall has noted, scholars often resist applying the critical skills that we bring to our subject matter to an examination of the textuality of our own profession, its scripts, values, biases, and behavioral norms. This kind of self-criticism is a risky endeavor, and those of us who've been privileged enough to succeed within the existing system are often reluctant to bite the hand that quite literally feeds us. Changing our technologies, however, changing our ways of doing research, changing the modes of production and distribution of that research, I would argue are all crucial to the continued vitality of the academy, and yet none of those changes will be able to come about unless there is first a profound change in the ways of thinking of scholars themselves. And until scholars genuinely believe that publishing on the web is as valuable as publishing in print, and even more importantly, until they believe that their institutions believe it too, few of them are going to be willing to risk their careers on a new way of working, with the result that that new way of working will remain marginal, undervalued, and risky. So in Planned Obsolescence, then, I'm focusing not just on the technological changes that many believe are necessary to allow academic publishing to flourish into the future, but on the social, intellectual, and institutional changes that are necessary to pave the way for that flourishing in the first place. In order for new modes of communication to become broadly accepted within the academy, scholars and their institutions must take a new look at the mission of the university, the goals of scholarly publishing, and the processes through which scholars conduct their work. We must collectively consider what new technologies have to offer us, not just in terms of reducing the cost of publishing or increasing access to publications, though those are huge issues that must be contended with, but in terms of how they will change the ways that we research, the ways that we write, and the ways that we review. And it's the structures of peer review that I argue we ultimately need to begin with, not least because over the course of developing MediaCommons and the dozens of meetings and conferences and panel discussions that I've participated in, every single conversation has come back again and again to the question of peer review. And, you know, no wonder, I suppose. Concerns about peer review are understandable given that it is in some sense the sine qua non of the academy. We employ it in almost every aspect of the ways that we work, from hiring decisions through promotion and tenure reviews, in internal and external grant and fellowship competitions, and, of course, in publishing. The work that we do as scholars is routinely and repeatedly subjected to a series of vetting processes that enable us to indicate that the results of our work have been scrutinized by authorities in the field and that those results are themselves therefore authoritative. But I also want to suggest that the current system of peer review is part of what's broken. There's a rather extraordinary literature available, mostly in the sciences and social sciences, on the problems with conventional peer review, including its biases and its flaws. And each and every scholar, I would be willing to bet, if they're being honest, has had direct personal experience of those flaws. The review that somehow misses the point, the review that must be personally motivated, or perhaps worst, in fact, the review that we never get to see. And for such an imperfect system, peer review as we know it requires a rather astonishing amount of labor on our part, for which we can never really receive credit. So when Matt Kirschenbaum says to me that what ought to count is peer review and scholarly merit, not the physical form in which the text is ultimately delivered, I agree, but feel at the same time quite strongly that the system of peer review that we know today could be vastly improved, particularly in a networked environment. And for that reason, I do want to force us to take a closer look at what we mean when we say peer review, and what it is we expect peer review to do, and how such processes might best work online. Now, one of the problems with using our current model of peer review in digital publishing is a fundamental misalignment between the net native means through which authority is determined online and what Mario Biagioli has referred to as the disciplinary technology of peer review, a decidedly Foucauldian mode of self-policing that regulates knowledge through discipline. The problem with transferring this disciplinary technology to the networked world is in no small part that the network has its own technologies. The placement of conventional peer review prior to selection for publication in the traditional print-based process indicates that it serves a primarily gatekeeping function, one that allows certain kinds of academic discourse to thrive while excluding other ideas from the realm of the thinkable. Now, this kind of gatekeeping is arguably necessary in print in order to cope with the scarcities of print's economics. Only so many pages in so many books and journals can be published each year. In the digital, however, this kind of scarcity is over, right? Because anyone can publish anything online, and from a perspective that values the free and open communication of the products of scholarly research, not only can but should, we face instead an extraordinary plenitude. And thus, in the part of the project that focuses on peer review, I argue that what digital scholarly publishing must develop is not a means of applying the current system of peer review to new modes of online work in order to create a sort of artificial scarcity, but rather as a means of coping with abundance, right? As it is, increasing numbers of scholars are already either self-publishing their work via their blogs or are forming new online publishing networks like MediaCommons. And in many cases, these kinds of publications are having a greater impact on the scholarly community than their traditional peer-reviewed publications are. And it's certainly true in my case. All of my first citations, lecture invitations, and other forms of public recognition stemmed not from my journal articles or from my book even, but from the work that I was doing on my blog. Now, these new modes of publishing demand some sort of assessment, right? Even if that assessment comes after the fact. And it's for that reason that I argue that peer review online needs to include some sort of open post-publication mode of review that doesn't determine whether a text should be published, because these things are already out there in circulation, but rather measures how it has been and how it should be received, and what its place in the ecosystem of scholarly communication is, what kinds of responses it's provoked. A system like this would shift the gravity of peer review from regulation to communication, right? Transforming it into a mechanism for facilitating more fluid and productive exchanges amongst peers. And not at all incidentally, a system in which the work of reviewing itself would become visible as work, and the reviews themselves part of the scholarly record. So what I argue is that we need to develop a system of peer-to-peer review, and one that takes advantage of networked publishing's capacity for discussion and dialogue, as well as of what Michael Jensen has called the new metrics of scholarly authority. Things like hits and downloads, of course, but also comments and inbound links and other forms of metrics that reveal how web-based texts get used. In order to provide a post-publication mode of filtering the wealth of content that should be made available via networked publishing. After all, to be honest, scarcity does linger in internet-based communication. It's just that for the most part, what has become scarce is time and attention rather than the materials of production. What internet-based scholarly publishing requires then is not filters or gatekeepers, but filters. Systems that allow a community of scholars working with and responding to one another to set and maintain their own standards, guiding one another to the best work that's being produced in their fields. So while Planned Obsolescence, while it's headed for print, it's actually going to be published by NYU Press later this year. As a means of sort of attempting to put my, at least metaphorical money, where my mouth is, I put the entire text online for open review. And it wasn't a perfect process, but parts of it were exciting. I was able to discuss the text at a much earlier stage of its development than I ordinarily would. I had reviewers who were actually discussing the text with one another, disagreeing on points of assessment, and I got to see that disagreement and actually participate in those discussions. And I also know a lot of things about the text and how it got read. For instance, I know that in the first 9 months after the project launched, it had over 31,000 page loads. Over 12,000 unique visitors came by for the first time, and over 3,300 of them came back repeatedly. 44 unique commenters left a total of 295 comments, and the project was written about and linked to in more than 20 venues that I was able to find, including one review article in a scholarly journal, right? The book hasn't even come out yet, and there's already a review article out about it. And it was taught this over the last year in at least 6 graduate seminars and 1 undergraduate class that I know about. And I just want to place that alongside the fact that the average scholarly press monograph in the humanities sells well fewer than 400 copies over its lifetime. Now, it's clear that an online process like this produces some complications, right? Not least for our notion of what publication is and what purposes it serves. Has my book now been published? When NYU releases the revised version, will that be a second edition? What will the status of the online version of the text be once the print version is out? And what's the relationship between the reader's comments and the text that's ostensibly mine, right? A broadly implemented peer-to-peer review system will inevitably require us to think in new ways about authorship, in no small part because such new modes of review will almost certainly necessitate a turn from thinking about academic publishing as being solely focused on the production and dissemination of individual products to instead imagining a system focused more broadly on facilitating the processes of scholarly work, as the time and effort required to maintain a gift economy-driven system of peer-to-peer review will require that scholars place some portion of their primary emphasis not on their own individual achievements, but rather on the advancement of the community as a whole. Now, this kind of collectivity is obviously a utopian ideal, and to a significant degree, it goes against all of our training as scholars, particularly as scholars within the humanities. I mean, what we accomplish alone. Or so it seems to us, at least. Roland Barthes, of course, claimed back in 1967 that no text is a single line of words, but that each instead is a fabric of quotations. I mean, we have long acknowledged the death of the author, at least in theory, but we haven't thought much about what such a proclamation might mean for our own status as authors, and I doubt any of us are willing to part with the lines on the CV that are the result of our own authorship. And I'm not arguing that we're going to have to, but what I do want to suggest is that digital networks, as structures that facilitate interaction, communication, and interconnection, will require us to think differently about what it is that we're doing as we write. And as the example of the blog might suggest, communities best engage with one another around writing that's open rather than closed, in process rather than concluded. Our new publishing systems that foreground process will likely encourage us to publish work earlier in its development, at the conference paper stage, for instance, and to remain engaged with those texts for much longer after they've been released to readers. Now, admittedly, this makes many scholars nervous about letting the messiness of our processes be seen, about the prospect of never being fully done with a project. But it's worth considering why we're doing the work in the first place. I mean, to the degree that scholarship is about participating in an exchange of ideas with one's peers, new network publishing structures can facilitate that interaction, but we'll do so best if the discussion is open-ended. Well, this foregrounding of process, however, may also likely require authors to be prepared to relinquish a certain degree of control over their texts, letting go of the illusion that their work springs wholly from the individual intelligence, and acknowledging the ways that scholarship, even in fields in which single authorship remains the norm, has always been collaborative. Right. The conversational structures of the web will inevitably intensify those collaborative relationships, sometimes producing new co-authoring relationships, but not always. It's clear, however, that we'll need to develop new kinds of citational practices that acknowledge the participation of our peers in the development of our work. And along the way, we'll also need to think differently about originality in scholarly production, recognizing that in a networked environment in which more and more discourse is available, some of the most important work that we will do as scholars may in fact more closely resemble contemporary editorial or curatorial practices, bringing together and highlighting and perhaps even remixing significant ideas in existing texts. We need to find new ways for these modes of authorship, process-centered, collaborative, remix-oriented, to count within our systems of evaluation. And there are many other such changes that will be required throughout the entire academic community if these kinds of publishing practices are to take root. Publishers, for instance, are going to need to think differently about their business models, which may need to focus more on services and less on the sale of objects. Their editorial practices, which may require a greater investment in guiding projects from an early stage in development work. And about the structures of texts, which may become less linear and will undoubtedly become less uniformly textual. They'll also need to think in concert with libraries about archival and preservation practices, ensuring that the texts that were being produced today remain available and accessible tomorrow. And universities, in the broadest sense, will need to rethink the relationship between the library, the university press, the Information Technology Center, and the academic units within the institution, reimagining the funding model under which publishing operates and the institutional purposes that such publishing serves, but also, and crucially, reimagining the relationship between the academic institution and the surrounding culture. As new systems of networked knowledge production become increasingly prevalent and influential online, the university and the scholars who comprise it need to find ways to adapt those systems to our needs, or we will run the risk of becoming increasingly irrelevant to the ways that contemporary culture produces and communicates authority. So in the end, what we in the Academy face today is less a material obsolescence than an institutional one. We're caught in a series of entrenched systems that no longer serve our needs as well as they might. But because we are, by and large, our institutions, or rather because they are us, the greatest challenge that we face is not, in fact, that obsolescence, but our response to it. Like the novelists that I studied in my first book, who feel their cultural centrality threatened by the rise of newer media forms, we can shore up the boundaries between ourselves and the open spaces of intellectual exchange on the internet. We can extol the virtues of the ways that things have always been done. And we can bemoan our marginalization in a culture that continues marching forward into the digital future. And in so doing, we can further undermine our influence on the main threads of intellectual discussion in contemporary public life. I mean, we can build supports for an undead system, and we can watch the profession itself become undead. Or we can work to change the ways that we communicate and the systems through which we attribute value to such communication, opening ourselves to the possibility that new modes of publishing might enable not just more texts, but in fact better texts, not just an evasion of obsolescence, but in fact a new life for scholarship. And the point, finally, is not whether any one particular technology can provide a viable future, but whether we have the institutional will to commit to the development of the systems that will make such a technology viable and keep it and ourselves viable into the future. Thank you. So, I would be happy to take questions if there are. Yes.
So I'm curious about how MediaCommons that you've seen working with it, any kind of genre changes in academic mm-hmm. writing, right? Since you're having people actually give input and you're more conscious of having to respond to people doing that, if you're seeing less rigid kinds of academic writing.
I am, and it's been really exciting. I mean, of course, the dirty little secret of the academic book is that really it doesn't get read, it gets consulted. As you said, you read the introduction, you probably look at the index and figure out where the parts that you actually need to look at more closely are. It's not a common thing for people to sit down and read the academic book as a text in and of itself. The blog post, on the other hand, lends itself to that kind of reading. Now, does that mean that we should all be writing in blog posts rather than books? No, I don't think so. I mean, I think there is a kind of work that gets done, particularly in those introductions of books, that can't be done without the long, lengthy sort of dwelling within a topic over time, right? The introduction is the point at which everything that happens afterwards gets synthesized and turned into something that's more than the sum of its parts, right? On the other hand, I think one of the things that happens on a lot of blogs frequently is that posts over time begin to build that argument sort of sequentially, serially, right? And so that you see the author's process sort of unfolding in that shift and change and response to community and so forth. Okay, so am I seeing new innovative forms of writing coming out of this? The ones that I'm most intrigued by are the things that are happening around, just went completely blank for a second, The New Everyday, which is the newest of the Media Commons projects, which is headed up by Nick Mirzoff at NYU, who's a visual culture scholar in the Department of Media, Culture, and Communication. And he's the one who has been sort of focused on this idea of middle state publishing, that when something has been, you know, slightly more elaborated but than a blog post, but isn't really an article yet, may be headed in that direction, may not, it might stay at this point. He's interested in getting that piece into dialogue with a cluster of other writers who are writing on the same topic. And so he'll pull together a cluster of 8 to 10 such essaylets that get published all in a clump, and that then have the authors sort of commenting on one another's pieces. So it's sort of like seminar in process, right? And that is the kind of thing that I really get excited about, is thinking about the ways that we really can allow the technologies through which we're disseminating our texts to help us sort of push them forward to become something more than what they were.
My question has to do with time management. I'm very interested in the blog that you've just described. I speak as someone who has never been on a blog. And part of the reason is I don't understand how to manage time. Mm-hmm. I am overwhelmed by my duties already. I spend way too much time simply on email or researching something online, not to speak of every once in a while getting to a library. How do you do this? How do you teach, review, blog, research, write? And how do you see this sort of playing out in the future of academia as we all move into this world in which you already inhabit, and I'm very interested in inhabiting, I just don't ever have the time to explore it. And the other thing is that review process, that group review process. I think you're absolutely right that we need to rethink the whole peer review issue. I think it's deeply, deeply flawed. But again, and again in a way, this is a time thing. So you've got 30 or 40 people commenting on your piece as you go. How do you deal with it? How do they deal with it? How much time are they putting in? How much time am I, when I peer review something the press has sent me, or if I'm doing an outside tenure review, I'm at least getting recognition for it. Every once in a while, I may get enough to go out to McDonald's for dinner. But when I'm peer reviewing a blog.
Yeah. These are exactly the right questions. And this is an enormous, enormous problem. The problem of time and labor in these processes is one that I don't pretend at all to have solved. It's one thing for me to put my manuscript online and have 30 or 40 of my closest friends come in and read it and discuss with one another and leave me comments and all of that. But when all 30 or 40 of them then post their manuscripts too, are all of us going to be able to read all of them, and how will we manage all of this? The same thing with journal issues. It's great right now when a journal uses an open review process because they get more feedback than the standard 2 to 3 blind reviewers that they might ordinarily get in a traditional process. But when every journal moves to this and everything is out there all the time, how are we going to manage this? Okay. I don't pretend to have good answers for this. Lindsay Waters in Enemies of Promise has this great moment at which he's sort of thinking in a somewhat curmudgeonly way about academic overproduction. I mean, as far as he's concerned, part of the problem is that we're producing too many books, that if we just stopped writing so many books and only focused on writing the good books, things would be better. And he's got this great image describing the ways that many faculty members come to feel like Charlie Chaplin in modern times, you know, madly rushing to keep up with the machinery. I tend to like Lucy in that I Love Lucy episode with the chocolate factory a little bit better. But same image, right? The machinery keeps going and you've got to keep up with it, which becomes more and more difficult the more machinery is there. I think some of what's required is just slowing down, right? Is recognizing that if we can turn our attention away from like the crux moment of the publishing process of doing all of this research and scholarship and writing and then having something published is the moment at which you finally get to put the line on your CV, right? Because now it is actually done and being published, and therefore it exists in a way. It has become concretized as a product. If we can get away from that moment as being the crux moment of this whole process, and instead understand the process of development over time as being just as important, right? If we get to see that process unfold, and so that, you know, you're working on a book, everybody expects it to take 3 years. In fact, it's taking you 8. But if it's taking you 8 and people are seeing that process visibly out there, they know why it's taking you 8, right? And it becomes, I mean, this is one of the things that, again, Lindsay Waters is arguing, that, you know, the masterwork that takes 15 years to produce is always much more important. But for those 15 years, does it appear that the scholar is being unproductive, right, and not coming out with the thing that they need to be producing? If we can stop focusing again on that sort of Fordist mode of production as end result, and instead think about how it is that we're communicating with one another, how we go through these processes, we might be able to slow down a bit and sort of give ourselves a little bit of a break in terms of all that work. Now, this doesn't solve the problem of the fact that there's just simply too much to do. There's too much to review. There is the nonstop email. I could go on about this at great length, obviously. One of the problems in the review process right now is that editors have a very hard time coming up with sufficient numbers of reviewers who are willing to take on the task, and so they come back to the same people over and over and over. So the people who peer review well end up doing way too much of it. And I mean, you know the same thing to be true of committee service within the university, right? The people who do it get called upon over and over again, and they're a minority within the university, right? We need to find ways to make that labor visible so that then it has to, of necessity, become more evenly distributed. One model that we've been proposing at MediaCommons, obviously we haven't put this into effect yet, but we're hoping to put in what amounts to a kind of pay-to-play system, right, in which you have to do a certain amount of reviewing in order to be able to have the right to put your material out there to be reviewed, right? As an active contributing member of the community, you earn the right to participate in its community processes, and without doing the reviewing, right? So at any rate, some ideas, certainly not a solution.
Hi. Thanks, Kathleen. That was a great talk.
Thank you.
My question is on one level just historical. I've not researched it, but I've always been under the impression that university presses have always been subsidized. Is that the case?
Yeah. University presses within the United States actually started out as the printing offices of universities. So when the university needed its graduation program, they sent it off to the university press to be published. It was literally the press out of which the paper came, right? There came a certain point in the 1920s-ish when some of the older university presses, Hopkins, University of California, began to professionalize. Earlier, they had done publishing of the sort that we understand university presses to do, right? They had published internally within the university the work of their own faculty and published it for free. This is fascinating, going back to the open access question, right? Published it for free and open distribution to university libraries around the country. This is how they got the work of their faculty out into the world to be read. And also libraries built up their collections by exchanging their monographs for the monographs of other institutions, right? At a certain point in the 1920s, there was this moment at which presses began to professionalize. Presses began separating from the university at this point, became revenue centers within the university, in part because they were starting to be seen as profitable and wanted to retain the profits for the future publishing of the press itself, and in part because they wanted to understand they wanted to see themselves as participating in the same professional mode of publishing books that trade publishers were engaged in. This is the point at which, the subsidy begins to retract in the 1920s, and by about the 1980s, it's in full retreat.
Okay, that's really neat. Let me just ask a follow-up. To the extent that, and I realize this is overstating for the sake of question, but to the extent that university presses have always, been A, doing things like at first distributing free copies and then the government subsidies, right? There's always been at least an implicit acknowledgement that humanities scholarship is not economically viable. And to accommodate for that unviableness, we have subsidies, free distribution, right? And if that's the case, and here overstatement again, but what has changed in recent years is not the viability of the book, but perhaps the degree to which we're willing to tolerate an non-viable form of knowledge.
I think that's a good way of putting it.
And that's particularly acute here at KU, here in Kansas, wherein our new governor has just proposed funding the university through the Department of Commerce, right? Which is a fairly bald-faced way of saying that the academy has to compete on the open market.
Right, right.
So how do we resist that? Well, one way to think about resistance, and maybe perhaps, and here's the question, one way to think about Media Commons is it's situated in a tradition of resistance that has always celebrated the non-viable forms of knowledge. And here I'm thinking of the liberal arts all the way back to Cicero, right?
Mm-hmm.
All the way back, in fact, before the printing press and the dawn of the book, right? That's sort of
Absolutely.
The defense of the non-viable is not a technology issue, per se. It's much more fundamental than that. It's about our approach to knowledge, what counts. And
yes.
for a while, the book played a role in that. Now the internet's going to play a role. And I guess the question then is how do we figure out the role of technology in this issue that's much bigger than just
mm-hmm.
sort of mode of production?
Oh, absolutely. I think that's a really, really smart way of thinking about what exactly is happening and how we need to think differently about what knowledge production is, right? I mean, we now think about knowledge production in this very Fordist manner, right? You produce knowledge, we can sell it, right? And clearly, on some level, the purpose of the humanities is to resist that, is to step back and think in a critical, thoughtful, slow way about values other than the values of the marketplace. Kathy Davidson once said in an article about the future of the University Press that if scholarly publishing, particularly in the humanities, were marketplace viable, we wouldn't need university presses. We would all be publishing with trade publishers, right? But clearly we're not. We actually need these institutionally supported venues in order to get this work out. The role that technology plays in this is enormous, I think. I mean, I think it's one of the reasons why so many scholars seem to be trending toward a DIY mode of publication. Is that, you know, I in fact can get my work out into better circulation by doing it myself than by going through the official mechanisms through which these things are supposed to be marketed and published and sold. The question is, do I get credit for having done it myself, right? If I publish everything that I write on my blog, will it ever appear that I've written and published anything when it comes time for personnel reviews? Clearly, to this point, the answer has been no, and yet the impact on the scholarly community of those blog posts can often be far larger than things that don't get that kind of circulation that go through the marketplace. So I think, I mean, it's really particularly at a moment like this, a moment of such extreme budgetary crisis in higher education, at a moment when we're being faced with questions from government, from business, about what purpose we serve, what products we are producing that we can then market. It's really important for us, I think, to think about that rhetoric and to resist it very strongly and to think about how we can find other modes of exchange. I mean, if scholarship is on some level, I mean, it's always been a gift economy, right? I mean, we might not do it for purely altruistic reasons, but on some level, the point of it is to contribute to the greater advancement of the knowledge of the whole, right? If there's never been a market in it, we need to find better ways to communicate that gift economy and why it works and what's important about it to the people who are asking us instead to think of our place, our roles within the marketplace.
Kathleen, a couple of questions, actually.
Sure.
First of all, in this vision that you've set out where the focus becomes process and scholarly community, what are the implications, and it strikes me as tremendous possibility for in graduate education,
yes.
because it seems that this opens up a whole new range of possibilities in terms of how we can train future scholars. So that's one question.
Mm-hmm.
The other is that And I know you're familiar with this because you're publishing their collection, the Alt-Ac.
Yes.
The Alternate Academic Careers, and all of the conversations that are emerging. For those who aren't familiar, scholars who have chosen alternative careers that are not within the tenure track line. What potential do you see there in the sense that they don't necessarily have some of those same constraints?
Right.
They value peer review. They value that they hold some of those same values around the importance of scholarly community, but they don't necessarily have the pressures of tenure review. So what potential do you see within that community?
Enormous potential, and I'm glad you raised the graduate education question as well. I'm gonna start with that one, and then don't let me forget, and I'll come back to the Alt-Ac question. I've actually been serving through the MLA on an ad hoc task force that was put together by the outgoing MLA president, Sidney Smith, to think about the future of graduate education, and specifically the future of the dissertation. Right. I mean, if we have for decades now sort of trained ourselves to think of the dissertation as a proto book, right? Because the expectation is that our students are going to get these tenure track jobs and they're going to need to produce the book within the first 6 years and get it published. They need to have it there in their pocket, pretty much ready to be revised and gotten out. In fact, a significant percentage of our graduate students are not going on to those tenure track positions. A significant percentage of those who do have books that, in fact, won't see publication, or at least not in the form that they're expected to in that proto-book stage. So this task force is attempting to think about what the dissertation might be if it were imagined to be broadly applicable to the range of different kinds of careers graduate students might, in fact, go on to have, right? If it were to be a document that's meant to be as useful as the proto book was, that demonstrates the same kinds of achievement, the same kinds of independent work that the current dissertation does, but does it in forms that might not necessarily be aimed at producing the same mode of publishing that we've been producing all along, what might it look like? Okay. We've been thinking some pretty pie in the sky stuff, and it's all really great, and eventually there will be a report. And I will not be at all surprised when that report has zero effect, as the task force on the evaluation of scholarship for promotion and tenure did. In no small part, the one thing that I didn't say when I was talking about the reasons why it didn't have an effect is that basically everybody sat back and said, this is all well and good, I would really love to change this, I'll change when Harvard changes. Right? When Harvard starts saying that you don't have to have a book to get tenure, six articles is fine, then our institution can say it too. And Harvard's never going to say that, because Harvard doesn't tenure any of its junior faculty, except a couple. And similarly with graduate education, until Harvard decides that the dissertation is something that can be some other form other than the proto book, it's not going to change, right? Because there is this sense of the keeping up with the Joneses factor within the university structure, right? We have to have aspirations to the tiers that are ahead of us. So I will not be at all surprised to see that the report that we put out may have less effect, less impact than we want it to. On the other hand, there are some fields where it is having a certain kind of impact. Rhetoric and composition, in fact, is really beginning to think quite strategically and quite innovatively about what a dissertation might be. There have been several really funky, multimedia, networked dissertations that have been released in that field over the last few years. They've had a tremendous impact. The students who have produced them have gone on to really fantastic jobs, and they're teaching in really innovative and new ways. And so I think that there are fields that can lead us in that direction if we will let them. But letting them may be part of the hard part. Okay, here's where the Alt-Ac folks come in, is that academics who aren't bound to the tenure clock, who aren't thinking about, who want peer review, but want peer review that's going to improve the quality of the work, not because then it's got the official seal of approval, right? Are able to take certain kinds of risks, willing to take certain kinds of risks with the material that they're working on in ways that scholars who are on the tenure track are often dissuaded from, are often told, you know, oh, don't publish in that venue, it's not serious enough, don't, you know, how is this going to be read at tenure time? No, don't do that really amazing database project that you've been thinking about until after you've gotten the book finished and published, right? And I think that some of what we're seeing in the great dialogue among the alternative academics who are going to be published in that series that Bethany Novisky is putting together is that there's a kind of freedom that comes from life not on the tenure track that might enable us to sort of look at what those scholars are producing as models for the rest of us and might free up what we're doing as well in response. I mean, that we see the impact that projects like those coming out of the Center for History and New Media, like those coming out of the Scholars Lab at University of Virginia, like those coming out of the Maryland Institute for Technology and the Humanities, that are being led by non-tenure track scholars. We can see the impact that they're having, and we can, you know, really want to sort of have that impact as well. It may help free the rest of us up too.
Would you just say a little bit more about your current project and the way that the process is working? I presume you're the one who wanted it to be pre-reviewed in the way that it is being. What did the press, or how did they respond to this idea? Is it NYU, you said?
Yes.
Are they happy about this idea that all the work has been out there for quite some time with people commenting and yet now we're going to a published
book form.
I just wondered how yeah. happy they were. I mean, clearly they are happy
yeah.
with this, but I just wondered if they had any qualms about it. And just as a footnote to this, you pulled the figures off a little quickly, so I couldn't really internalize them all, but I don't know what one makes of the fact that something like 12,000 people seem to have gone onto the site to
mm-hmm.
see your work, and yet only 44 ended up by commenting or making a comment. Now, they made something like 300 comments, but
yeah.
44 is a very small number. I mean, maybe that's good that you didn't have to respond to 12,000 comments.
Oh, truly. I was just looking for that slide so that I could put those numbers back up again, and I'm not finding it. In any event, what did NYU think of this? When I first was in contract negotiations with them, I had discussion with Eric Zinner, who's my editor there, about wanting to do something, you know, in terms of getting the material out there to do some bloggy, peer review-y type thing. And he said, yes, I think that would be fine. And was sort of imagining that what I was going to do was something along the lines of what Siva Vaidyanathan did with his Google book, which is on its way out, which is basically sort of blog the research process, finding bits of the material that I'm working with that I wanted to write about, writing small chunks of the text in public in an ongoing way. And in fact, that wasn't at all what I had in mind. I was far enough along in the process of producing the book that wasn't really how I wanted to go at it. So we had a long discussion about the way that I wanted to do it. And there was a little resistance only because it had never been done before. They were a little puzzled about why I would want to do it that way and a little puzzled about what it would mean to do it that way. To NYU's credit, and this is in part because they're one of the last remaining profitable university presses out there, they thought of themselves as being able to experiment with at least one book, right? That they could just test it out and see what would happen. So after a little bit of negotiation, we figured out how to go at it. Part of what made them okay with the way that I wanted to do this, putting the entire text out there, was ultimately the argument that I made to them that the book that I have written has two audiences, two very separate audiences. There's very little overlap in this Venn diagram. There are the people who are willing to sit there and read it online and interested in commenting on it, basically the choir, right? And then there are the people who actually need to read it but really want to read it in print. Provosts, deans, chairs of promotion and tenure committees, people who really, really want the argument, need to understand these issues, but aren't yet in that space, understanding how these digital modes are working.
Right. And because it is two such separate audiences, I think NYU was willing to look at it and say, yeah, actually, probably the fact that these people read it online isn't going to affect sales to these people. And these are the ones we're ultimately trying to reach. So ultimately, I think, you know, that was great. What do we make of the fact that 12,000 people, you know, came by and only 44 of them left comments? Yes, I was relieved. I wouldn't want to deal with 12,000 people talking in the margins. And Comment Press, the form that we used, which I'm sorry I wasn't able to actually show you what that looks like, at a certain point becomes discussion becomes unmanageable within its spaces. The way that the page is laid out, it can become very difficult to keep up with a thread of conversation. So that it was as few as it was actually fine with me. And in part because 44 was a heck of a lot more than 2 to 3, right? So it seemed to me a vast improvement in that sense. And that I did have reviewers sort of talking and disagreeing with one another was really useful to see where the points of disagreement were, where the things that I clearly touched a nerve on were, where I really needed to spend more time. Now, the thing that was really interesting to me, though, is watching people's patterns of reading. It won't come as a great shock, going back to the reading the introduction question. The first couple of chapters have a whole lot more comments than the last chapter does. Right? Things sort of tail off as you go through, and it's very clear that a lot of people came in, read one chapter, commented on that chapter, and that was what they read. But frankly, I think that's okay. With this mode of publication, I think it's fine for people to sort of dip in the places where they're interested in a particular issue and leave their mark on that spot where they have some kind of knowledge and authority to contribute back and not necessarily deal with the manuscript on the whole, particularly given that that's how we read the book a lot of times anyway.
This is to follow up on that old ACK comment that
yes.
you made a few minutes ago. People who can take the risk of doing things differently, innovatively, because they are not caught up in the promotion and tenure issue. I'm wondering if another constituency that could also contribute is senior faculty, who
yes.
are, you know, not so concerned about those matters as well, but who maybe are too fuddy-duddy-ish to do much here. Do you have any experience or thoughts on that?
I would say that that's a community that not only can contribute, but must contribute. That senior faculty who are really invested in these kinds of questions have to step forward and take these kinds of chances. At a certain point, I mean, what we're hoping is that if we can convince someone of the sort of scholarly significance of just, you know, off the top of my head, Henry Jenkins, to publish a really significant monograph with MediaCommons, anybody else who follows after that will not have the same kind of trouble convincing their tenure and promotion committee that this is a serious place to publish, because Henry Jenkins published his last book there, right? And therefore, it's a serious thing. So senior faculty have to step forward and take that chance. The other thing that senior faculty have to do, however, because I think I don't want to fall into the framework of thinking that happens a whole lot, which is that, okay, it's fine for senior faculty to take that kind of chance, but junior faculty should not do that. They should publish with University of Pennsylvania Press and wait until after they get tenure to do this wacky stuff. I actually think that junior faculty need to do this work as well, that we all need to be moving in that direction. The main thing that senior faculty need to do is have the backs of the junior faculty who are doing this kind of work. They need to understand why the junior faculty want to work in this way, what the benefits are, and be able to argue on their behalf in tenure and promotion letters, outside evaluations, and so forth. So, I mean, really, senior faculty are the ones who will ultimately make this a viable system in terms of tenure and promotion, but it's both through their participation in the process and in their arguments on behalf of the process with their colleagues.
I'm one of those senior faculty.
I was thinking back to the review process again, and certainly I think 44 people commenting on your work in progress is a lot better than 2 or 3. I'm actually very down on the peer review process right now. It seems to me very much a broken chip. But I also, and your comment about the difficulty of getting peer reviewers, it seems to me that one thing that's very beneficial that could come out of this is that you get a pool of people. So 12,000 people visit the site, 44 people make a comment. Out of that, you could assemble a team of, let's say, 4 to 8 people, mm-hmm. and then some of those could become the peer reviewers. And these are people who obviously by then have a stake in this book.
Yes.
And they want to review it. They know something about it in progress. So I don't exactly know how it would work, but it seems to me to be, rather than publishers or chairs of departments fishing around who do you know who might be good for reviewing her book, then there's people out there already,
right.
that there's a process.
Right, you have a community that's already participating in this ongoing discussion. This is a big part of how Shakespeare Quarterly went about their open review experiment that they did with us. Shakespeare Quarterly, incidentally, not the most avant-garde journal in literary studies, extremely eminent. And yet was doing this special issue on Shakespeare in new media, and the special issue editor, Catherine Rowe, argued to the editorial board that if we're really going to be thinking about new media as it's being applied to Shakespeare scholarship, right, doing certain kinds of syntactic analyses through large data mining projects and things like this, that we really also need to think about the role that new media is playing in the ways that scholars themselves are doing their work, and we need to put this into practice in the special issue. So she managed to convince them to test out this open review process with us, modeled on the one that had been put in place for my book. The difference that the editorial board of Shakespeare Quarterly requested was that, there were a couple of differences, one of which is that on the review of my book, I wanted people to leave their names, but I didn't require them to leave their names. They didn't have to register for accounts. They could just come in and leave a comment with a screen name if they felt like it. Shakespeare Quarterly insisted that that everyone register for an account, that they use their names, that they be public about their identities, because it was really important to maintain both a sense of community in this process, but also for the junior scholars who were the authors of a couple of the articles that were under review, to be able to demonstrate that really eminent senior people in their field participated in this process, and therefore it was real peer review, and not just their friends saying nice things anonymously. How Shakespeare Quarterly went about this is that they took their usual go-to list of peer reviewers, the editorial board, the other folks that they send articles to, and they went out to all of them and said, here is this process that we're about to engage in, this is how it's going to operate, these are the instructions for doing this, will you commit to reading at least one of these essays and leaving comments on it? And with only a few exceptions, everybody committed to doing at least that much. And in fact, everybody participated more than that. They actually ended up leaving more comments. And it was because it was, exactly as you say, material that they were invested in, right? They had a stake in the outcome of that review, in what was happening within their own field. And they really wanted the material to be as good as it could be. But the exciting thing that happened was that in addition to that usual go-to list, a whole bunch of other people, having heard about the project, came along and also registered and created accounts and left comments. And many of them were people who were vitally invested in Shakespeare studies, but not as scholars per se. There was a filmmaker who had been working on the production of a Shakespeare-based film, who came by and left some comments on one particular essay that had to do with video production in Shakespeare. And there were there was a dramaturg from a theater who came by and left comments on an essay that had to do with performance. And it was really fascinating to see the ways that multiple forms of scholarly authority or of authoritative knowledge were able to be deployed in this review process rather than strictly scholarly knowledge in really productive ways.
It's a lot easier to pull this off when the topic is new media right? And so it seems like that's a huge barrier for us to jump. When I went up for tenure, it was, well, it's okay that she's published stuff electronically because she studies the internet.
Yeah, right.
Right, so right. How do we make the argument to the academy that it's okay that he published online because he studies Chaucer?
Right. Right. That is a really, really good question. After the Shakespeare Quarterly experiment, there was one journal in medieval studies that decided to take up their own experiment. It's not going through Media Commons. They're doing this themselves with open review. And it's not a new media-based issue at all. It's just medieval studies. But it's a cluster of scholars, many of whom have blogs, many of whom participate on one group blog, and who are already in dialogue with one another and just saw this as being an extension of the ways that they're working in other venues, so why not apply it to the journal as well? I think that kind of spread will only happen over time and only gradually. As different fields come to see the usefulness of these ways of working. I mean, and this is, you know, in addition to senior scholars needing to model this kind of change, I have argued very strongly, very forcefully, that in fact, fields like media studies must model this change first, because we do have that freedom. You know, we can at least make the argument that form has to follow content, right? And that we really do need to sort of treat this as a mode of investigation of the things that we're studying. But gradually, I think that kind of work is going to happen. There are a cluster of scholars in American studies who are working in digital humanities projects there, who are not studying the digital, who are doing fairly, what would otherwise be thought of if they were doing it in print as traditional historical work, but are recognizing that by doing this work online, they're able to actually bring the materials of the archive directly to bear in the argument rather than sort of describing those materials. Right? And so they're now making those connections between these new modes of publication and better argumentation. And I think gradually that will begin to happen elsewhere. Not all fields may lend themselves to it. There may be some fields that simply work better in the old way. And I don't want to say that, you know, automatically everybody has to go in that direction, but, you know, I think gradually more and more fields will figure it out. Thank you very much.
Thank you.